Hello and welcome to the Rioho Wellness Podcast. This is Margit Jeppesen and I am here with Andre Gospodarczyk, the founder of Rioho. The vision behind Rioho Wellness is to create a tipping point in wellness worldwide, and this podcast will contribute towards that. In each episode, we explore different health issues that present as case studies in Andre's practice. They range from everyday common health problems through to extremely serious health issues and illnesses. We explore body parts and how they respond to nutrition and environment, and we work on inspiring people to change their life for good through an everyday wellness focus. Rioho is a wellness modality that is unique because it focuses on healing and wellness through basic food and exercises that maneuver the body back to a state of balanced health. People literally jump out of their skin with energy and vitality when they follow Rioho. And it's an incredible turnaround for many who have had low energy for years through to people who have had complex health issues that don't seem to budge. The podcast is an interview format and ranges from 20 to 60 minutes. And if you'd like more of an introduction on Andre, please see the 3-minute introduction in the first podcast on the homepage. And at the end, I'll be here to give you a little bit more information. So without further ado, let's get into this episode. Andre, when we were planning the next podcast, we were talking about spring and how it would be fantastic to do a spring podcast. And here we are, just about on the 1st of September. And I would like to understand more about your passion for spring, because you became quite excited about the concept of spring and you said that you had a lot to say about spring to help our listeners really harness the energy and the possibility of spring into their lives, both on a wellness level and a lifestyle level. So could we start off with a broad introduction to spring from your perspective, and can you explain exactly why you are so passionate about this season coming up?
The season changes dramatically in spring, and we look around and we see the forces of nature at work, and one day we get up and the street is covered in blossoms. The flowers explode out of the branches and the life-giving energies of nature bubble up out of the ground and are manifested fairly clearly as a force. Lots of plants break through the ground and show themselves as sprouts and leafy greens. Everything grows very quickly. There's lots of little animals are born. It's an interesting time of very dramatic shifts and great change. And it's obvious. But what people don't realize is that explosion of life and nature showing itself as a great creative force is also happening in us. Exactly the same thing. It bubbles up in us and explodes out. Now, what that means is that it's a great time of renewal. It's a powerful time of healing, and it affects us in all sorts of profound ways. Unfortunately, if you're not ready for it, it's too much. Now, just the same as a tree with very weak roots and poor structural integrity, a branch laden with too much will break. It'll snap off. We don't want that to happen to us. So all the energy rises up, and there's no stopping that. We need to be able to be grounded enough to allow that to fully manifest. So the winter time is a time of stabilizing and grounding, and the spring energies are a time of stuff bubbling up out of the ground and manifesting as expressions of that abundance that is manifest in the flowers and the life forces of nature showing themselves very, very clearly. There's all sorts of perfumes, there's all sorts of colors, there's all sorts of flowers, there's all sorts of sprouts, but they're only little. That's in us. It's a feeling of excitement and possibilities. Now, traditionally, we would have some kind of reflection of that socially, and we now call it Easter in this hemisphere of the world. on the southern side. Down under, we've got it in autumn, but the rest of the world has that rebirthing idea in spring, where it rightly should be. Now, it's just an analogy of what's going on, of, you know, lots of little rabbits jumping around and people coming back to life and all sorts of things like that. And that happens in us, where the life-giving forces bubble up. And why that's very, very exciting is that out of a nothingness, out of a potential that is hidden, things can appear as a little glimpse of delightful newness and possibilities. Inside us, there's organs that support this function of rebuilding and newness, of rebirthing, of fresh, and of a time of great healing and letting go of the past and starting again. As a daytime analogy, let's look at the whole year as a one day. It's a time of the morning where lots of energy is bubbling up and it lasts for a short time and it's very fresh and alive. When I was studying with one of my yoga teachers, Sachinanda, someone asked him about running in the city or jogging in the morning and how the air is really bad and you shouldn't. He said, if you get up just at dawn, in that early time, the air is always fresh. And it's a bit like that. So early morning, there's a great time of upheaval and change and freshness, and all the birds are alive and singing and dancing, and there's a time of great activity around us. Maybe most of us are still in bed, that's okay. But nevertheless, nature is providing that. And like I said before, it's happening in us, whether you like it or not. That morning time of the year is the springtime. Danger is if you're not grounded, like I said, then you get a little bit top heavy. Now, people get very cranky when they've got too much energy in their upper body and feeling insecure and unstable because of weakness in their bones, weakness in their stability, weakness in their spine. What that means is that the organs that are associated with the spring energy and the rebirth and renewal, the liver and gallbladder functions that maintain our aliveness and our healing capacity, can become overactive if we overstimulate them. Food-wise, if you're eating too much rich food that really should be autumn food or winter food, is going to create liver damage. You have to eat the right way for the seasons. Eat what's available and you'll find this lovely lightness comes in. Now, why that's so important is that from just a simple little idea, from a simple wish and a simple dream of having this potential in us, it can bubble up into a reality. What I'm saying is that at this time of year, if you can have a positive thought about where you want your life to go, what direction you want it to go in, you have the potential at this time to make that happen. When we run in the morning, my training is based on a very simple idea of not so much creating fitness. There's a lot of very fit people who are not well, of course. I mean, there is that component of getting the body a little bit circulation, but more about setting a particular attitude for the day and watching that manifest throughout the day. When you get that little possibility of creating an idea first thing in the morning, when you get that little possibility happening in your life of having an attitude adjustment and a little possibility of a dream starting off in the morning, having the right idea and setting that as a quality for the rest of the day and just letting it go and then watching it blossom throughout the morning. So springtime is a time of making dreams a reality. From a seeming nothingness, a dead branch, the next day something beautiful and alive, fragile, yes, but there's that manifestation and we just nurture that into reality. We have that potential in spring. It's a very exciting time. Eating rich food that is inappropriate in spring is going to create drama. In other words, irritability, anger, agitation, because there's so much energy around, we don't want to create richness. Let's look at it as a simple nutritional process. Autumn time, there's a little bit more abundance around in terms of animals and food. The animal herd is culled a little bit and it's easier to catch animals and set traps and find a little bit of that sort of food if you're eating animals. Also, it's a time of gathering seeds and nuts, and we tend to accumulate a little bit extra fat, and some heavier foods are part of our normal diet, beans, grains. That's the winter time. So a little bit more towards protein and fats. Now, what happens in spring is nature then provides a very different source of nutrition, leafy greens and sprouts and different kinds of sweet foods. Now, they're full of the vitamins and minerals, the enzymes that we need to break down the abundance and the excess of fats and proteins that we've accumulated over the autumn and winter time. And it's nature's way of making us lighter and cooler and fresher. So eating what's available in the stores. In other words, eat lots of vegetables now and reduce the grains, reduce the fats. That way you're nurturing the lighter aspects of yourself and cooling your body down a little bit. It's a good way to go, just chemically. All right. As an idea, you might have gotten that if you're a little bit heavy, if you're a little bit saturated fat abundant, if you're carrying a little bit of excess on your thighs, you have some cellulite, your buttocks, your waist, your skin's a bit dry. This is the time where you can lighten all of that up and freshen everything, make everything light and flexible and create new possibilities in your existence physically and emotionally and make great change in your life. Spiritually also, by nurturing that aspect of yourself. So normally in the springtime, there's a little idea of fasting. There's a little time of reduced rich food intake, that little gap between the end of the food stores in winter and the beginnings of fresh food in spring. There's a little time there where it's sensible to reduce our food intake and allow the body to freshen up. So traditionally, people would do their fasting in the springtime. It's a good time to do that sort of thing. Let your body clean out and create new possibilities. Exciting time. Now, my suggestions to all of you is have a little dream. Make some simple idea a reality by every day. Just have it written down somewhere and remind yourself and then let it go. If you want more material abundance in your life, have a big dream of great amount of abundance. If you're wanting $1 million, let's go for $1 billion and not have a small dream like $1 million. Let's go for $1 billion. If you're wanting more health, you want to be a little bit slimmer, you want to have better knees, better neck, better back, why not think about feeling absolutely fantastic and feeling like you were 15 again? And absolutely pain-free and on top of the world and never having a problem again. Why not have a great dream like that? Big dreams. No need to dream little dreams. We're amazing creatures, human beings. We can do incredible things if we can support ourselves and know how we operate. Just a quick little view of that whole process again. We build potential and structure in the winter time. It's like a big sleep. It's a quiet time. I know we all have factory lives. I know we do the same thing in winter as we do in spring, as we do in summer, but that's not actually how we are. It's certainly not how nature is, and we're part of that process. It's a very different time, springtime. It's a short window of waking up and creating great new possibilities in your life. One thing you can do is freshen up your diet and live on very light food, salads and vinegars and lots of leafy greens and lots of vegetables. Reduce your salt, reduce your proteins, and let your body lighten up. Flexibility and new possibilities are there for the taking in spring. A very exciting time. New directions in your life. Very exciting time. Just pick a direction. Let something happen or else it just turns into chaos. The only problem is when you create a new dream, something else has to disappear. So it's okay for old things to go away. Let the new thing come. It's a great, great time. Let your immune system start to operate again. Let things heal. Let things manifest. Now, in Western medical science, we know that they've chopped up a lot of bodies and examined a lot of things and done a lot of test tube studies, and they found that the liver processes proteins and then uses that to repair the body. Now, if we're going to nurture our liver into full functionality, what we need to do is give it a chance to repair really old injuries. Really big problems can heal up. It's not difficult. just lean towards more vegetables, keep away from heavy saturated fats and foods that are associated with autumn and winter. Now, that means seeds and nuts, not so many. Sesame seeds, not so much of a problem. They're not rich in fats. But things like peanuts, almonds, cashew nuts, keep them very low. You'll see they don't work in spring. Lots of grains, reduce them. Lots of beans, reduce them. Lean towards much more vegetable fuel. You'll feel so much better. Fruit, it hasn't manifested yet. Maybe some berries. Go on your feelings. Lots of fresh food. It's a great way to go. Stir frying now is a great time to have oily foods. Oil is very viscous. That's what we want in our lives, a time of great change, not heaviness. Keep away from things that are stuck and rigid, like saturated fat, where it doesn't allow any movement. Keep away from animal quality proteins. Autumn, winter, maybe that's not such a bad thing for some of us, but it's certainly not a thing you want to do in springtime. Let yourself lighten up. Get away from heaviness. Your energy is going to come from a different place in spring. It's going to come from underneath and bubble up. We don't need to feed ourselves with bones and muscle tissue and blood. It's the wrong sort of food in spring. Change your diet in spring. Let yourself flow with that new energy. Have a new idea. Hang on to it for a couple of weeks. The window is almost there. You can feel it around you. Everyone's a little bit excited and getting frisky. Let's all of us bathe in that enormous energy. We don't need to get it from food. It comes from underneath. Enjoy the fresh foods that are available out there, and it'll unlock the potential in you that is sitting dormant emotionally, mentally, physically, spiritually. There's great potential there in all of us. And nutritionally, we know that the enzymes and the vitamins that we're getting from the foods available now will unlock the potential we've created over winter. I know all of you have been eating a lot of good solid food over the winter time. Now's time to flip it, change it, lighten it up just for a few weeks and create great abundance and lots of great enjoyment and happiness and support for ourselves with the summer harvests that come from simple idea of having the right idea now. I hope you all enjoy spring.
It's really amazing to hear that introduction and the background to your passion. I really tapped into the promise and the excitement of a fresh start and new growth spring gives us. And I'm picturing, you know, animals and plants and flowers and people really very light, spirit light. In listening to it, I did pick up on a few things that I'd like to unpack with you. And the first one is about the changes that we're seeing in nature, in weather patterns, in what's going on outside our windows effectively. And really the question is about global warming and the impact on our biorhythms. We're seeing a lot of changes to nature where halfway through winter, we're seeing some trees flower when they shouldn't be, warm currents coming through, and then it reverting to being very cold, and then it might be very warm again. And so if you look at it, there could be a state of confusion out there amongst nature. So how does that affect our biorhythms and what we should be doing in our lives in terms of spring?
Sure. It's even more important to be then flexible. So being very flexible in times of great upheaval and adjustment needs to be made. Now, if we think about all the drama that nature is having, you'll see that in certain environments where the ice is melting and the polar bears are having a really hard time, different animals are suffering enormously. They're finding that animals can't adjust as well as us to great seasonal changes. They're more dependent. We're much more flexible, and we have to be able to adjust to these changes and know that, okay, yes, there's a lot hotter winters, and there's going to be much bigger storms, and it's terrifying to think about how hot this summer is going to become, and it's scary to think about these droughts that are coming and maybe floods again. But that's where we have to be even more spring adjusted and even more flexible and more open to change and possibilities, because it's you know, who knows what's going to happen next. We have to even have more ability to adjust. Unfortunately, animals are more environmentally dependent. They don't have that ability to adjust from creating a dream and having that kind of self-awareness where we can look at ourselves and think dreams and make them manifest and create great change. They don't have that possibility of manipulating nature around them the way we do. So yes, it's a time of upheaval, and my answer is very simple, which is spring is a time of upheaval and great change, and there's that sort of problem for different reasons happening in winter, and I'm sure in summer. This summer is going to be as scary, maybe even more so than last summer, who knows? But that's where health and flexibility becomes even more important. Be aware of your surroundings, watch the seasons, be even lighter within yourself than normal, and let's be more flexible in ourselves by not eating foods that make us rigid and heavy and dependent. I remember a little while ago that there was some little problem in one of our southern cities in Melbourne where they ran out of milk. There was some problem with dairy, I don't know what it was, and it was mass hysteria practically. It was horrendous, and I remember very clearly that we'd run out of petrol and electricity would disappear for 2-3 days at a time when I was a teenager. We didn't have that sort of stability that we have now, and it was not a problem. My grandmother would make shadow puppets. It's we have to be flexible, and it's not something that we are anymore, and it shows in being irritable, angry, and insistent. And a person who's flexible is much more into the spring energy, where they can shift their mind a little bit and not be heavy like you're in the winter time, but be much more flexible and adaptable. And that comes from having a very healthy immune system, which is the liver and gallbladder functions, where it repairs damage in us and adjusts and changes to a changing environment. It's even more important now than ever, Maggie.
In terms of the timing of the 1st of September, which is officially the first day of spring, and we're looking out the window and it's cold and we've got the heaters running and we can see some movement and some spring coming, do we just use that as a contextual marker to say, okay, well, it's coming soon, so I'm going to start preparing, even though I still feel that it's a bit wintry, particularly for the southern states, I guess. Is that what you're saying, that, yeah, we see nature and we know that it's not quite there yet and there's changes out there, but that's the contextual marker, so let's get ready.
Yeah, and it's like dawn. Just before the sun rises, there's a little wind that comes through. It's called a little zephyr, and it just rips around the planet. And just ahead of dawn, it gets pulled around, and it's a little cool wind that rushes through quickly over a 30-second moment, and that's when you make your wishes come true, by catching that little breath. And it's important to get ready at that time, just before then. Maybe that 1st of September day is not so important. Maybe it's a week before, maybe it's a week after. It's not so important, the 1st. But on the other hand, around that time, it's going to happen. I mean, it changes, you know, dawn changes during the year. And as a cycle, we go through epochal changes. So over a century, that spring moment shifts. You know, not only do we have a daily change over a season where dawn is earlier or later, we also have that happen as a yearly thing. So think about a whole year as a one day. The winter is the nighttime, summer is the middle of the day, spring is the early morning, and think of the evening time as autumn and see that as a big one day. And then think about a period of roughly a century as a time of a 1 year, and you can start to see that kind of pattern where the seasons shift a little bit, and then they go back again, then they go forward again, and things, these changes happen. It's not so accurate the 1st of September, but it's around that time. Just keep your mind open. It's not absolutely precise. You know, we're not dealing with computers here that insist that you think in a particular way, and if you get it wrong, nothing happens. It's not quite like that. We can feel it's a little adjustment, you know, that nature and us connect, and it's like having a conversation. You get a little response within yourself, you make a little action, change your diet a little bit, and you can feel it, you know, you can respond in a relational way here, where you use a little bit more oil and you can feel, I ate too much oil last night, and that was a bit too rich. I'll keep going with the grains for a little bit longer. I'm still feeling a bit cold, so I'll keep up my grain intake, and I still want some salt, and I like my rich miso, I like my beans still. And as the week changes, you go, gee, you know, I'm really into veggies at the moment and not so keen on buckwheat and heavy foods, and I'm lightening up my gamasio and using a ratio of 20 or 30 to 1 in my seeds and salt, and reducing my shoyu and tamari intake. So we can be a little bit flexible there.
Yeah, I love that analogy of four seasons in one day, and I'd never really thought about that before, but it's just fantastic to be able to get up every morning and say, okay, the dawn is the spring and that's the time for renewal, and you can really set the frame for the whole day.
Yeah, have a dream every morning and set it by pushing yourself to the limit a little bit, set the right attitude, have the right little idea every morning as a spring thing. And you can do that for the rest of your life. And then in the afternoon and in the evening, reassess and check yourself and think, did I have a beneficial day? Was it a day of a newness that I created? Did I have the right attitude this morning that then manifested and bore the right fruit in the middle of the day? And am I resting comfortably and satisfied? There's a lovely idea the Chinese have, which is that we all wear our bodies out, but did you wear it out the right way? Are you satisfied? Are you comfortable with that? Are you judging yourself satisfied, fulfilled, and happy with everything that manifested that day? And we all make mistakes, and it's all great. And then the next morning you have another chance of creating the right attitude. My suggestion is get up, do strong movements. Once you reach your limit, don't push yourself harder in your strong movements of jogging or push-ups or anything. Set that strength of mind into your body by hitting your barrier and relaxing your body. Change your breath, change your attitude, push yourself a little bit further so every day you can rise above yourself as a spring thing. And that's what we should be doing now in the spring energy, is setting a standard for ourselves so where we can rise above ourselves for the following year and set ourselves some goals of earning more wealth, earning more health, earning more respect from our peers, deserving, create a deserving in ourselves of health, abundance and beauty around us. It's a great time, Maggie.
You just touched on a really amazing point in that there's a lot of people who quest every day. They go out and they quest for something, and it's a very physical quest, and it's a very difficult quest because often they're pushing very hard for something to happen, when in actual fact, what you just talked about, bringing the strength of their mind into their body and letting things go and setting an intention would possibly make that quest a little easier through the day and a little more productive.
Yeah, we're complex beings. We're not just physical structures. And in fact, having the right attitude, the right idea, and the right whim as the first step is the right thing. Now, it's a very good understanding to have within ourselves that you can't just change your attitude, you can't just become a better person, and you can't just overnight or in that moment change everything. There's many aspects of us, and the first aspect is that direction in life, our dream, and that little whim can bubble up. Well, we have to grab that. We have to grab that and nurture that little idea, that little whim. I mean, whole wars start on an idea. By the time the war is underway and people are shooting each other, it's kind of too late. It's that little idea at the very, very beginning that is actually the power. It's where you can make the change. If you've got the wrong attitude, then it's only going to turn into a disaster. Having the right whim, having the right dream is absolutely important. Now, the Buddhists have a lovely, lovely saying, which is you can do all the right things in life with the wrong attitude and you go straight to hell. On the other hand, you can do apparently all the wrong things with the right attitude, you go straight to heaven. It's a good idea to have in your head.
I think that I just really love that spring analogy, and that every dawn is a new spring. Similarly, the analogy of New Year's Eve and the excitement of the 1st of January, that there's a new year coming, and setting intentions for the year and thinking, okay, last year was last year and it wasn't my best, but this year it's going to be my best. And really that excitement, that inner excitement about something new and fresh, is what you're suggesting we can do every single morning.
Absolutely. Now, yeah, every morning, but now is the time we can do with nature's help on a great level. We can create massive changes now because we kind of are really primed for it food-wise, energetically, and nature is right behind you for the next few weeks to let it bubble up out of the ground. Just be aware of it, create the idea, sit back, relax, and watch it happen, and then the hard work comes a little bit later. Now is the time for dreaming, setting standards, creating focus, putting new directions in your life, and just watch them unfold almost automatically. And then you can jump in there and do the hard work. It's no good just working hard physically all the time. You've got to have the right intention. Follow that nature's process. So in nature, we see a tree with its little blossom popping out. And then the work starts where it's sucking juices up from the ground, and lots of work is happening there in the flower. Then the bees come and there's lots of work there and lots of energy expended, and great changes in the flower happens and it turns into fruit. You know, it's lots of hard work comes later. But now it's the time of just creating that idea. So we have a chance now of a long morning and great abundance happening. It's a great time. And we're coming into that whole spring energy very soon in the next epoch. It's an interesting time for humanity. We'll see what happens. But let's practice now with this spring. Let's all have a go at creating a whole new direction. Big dreams, don't make little dreams. And you can make dreams for other people too. Let's have a go.
One of my teachers a long time ago used a similar analogy of a farmer in his fields and the seasons of change and how our lives are aligned. So during spring, the farmer sows the seeds, and then in summer, the crop grows and ripens. And during autumn, the food is harvested and some seeds are put aside. And during winter, the farmer rests the land, hibernating for renewal that's coming in spring, and so the cycle goes on. But the point of me saying this is that the farmer reaps what he sows in spring, same as us. We reap what we have sown in the springtime of our life, and you're saying, Andre, it's a magnificent opportunity for us to dream and set intentions and goals during spring. In other words, plant the seeds. I love it. I think it's a great analogy, and we can use it for health and wellness, but also for work and family and career and anything really. So another question that came into my mind was, you talked about that it's a powerful time for healing and renewal, but if you're not ready for it, it's too much. So can you talk us through that and unpack that a little bit more for me, please?
If you're not ready for change, it can be dramatic in our lives, and we get very tense. Being not ready means we're not open to the changes that are happening emotionally, mentally, but also there's a big component which I think is really important, which is what I focus on, which is basics. There's a lot of people out there with awesome wisdom, amazing intellects and great understanding of how things work, but not everyone's talking about what happens on a really basic level in us. And those basics are what matters a lot of the time. When you're in pain, it's very hard to be spiritual and questing and wise and optimistic. It's very difficult to get on with your life if there's pain in your back or in your ribs or you're having a heart attack. It's basics are really important. So this the basic idea of having structural integrity is what we need over that winter time. And if you're not ready for the change and you don't have that structural integrity, then you can get really toppled over. You can get very angry, very irritable, and that irritability very easily turns into rage. Watch around you over the next few weeks how great the change is around you in politics, in the people around you, in the environment, in society. It's a great time of change in the spring energy. And watch it overseas. If you're in the northern hemisphere, then you'll find that spring energy next year, as it hits, you can watch it. It's very dramatic around you. We can watch you next year from our autumn time go through massive upheavals. Now, it happens all the time. There's upheavals everywhere, but we need our stability. And if you don't have your stability, then the great change, if you're not ready for it and you have something dramatic happen, you fall over. It's really a shame. The way you can protect yourself against that now, even if you're not really that stable, is don't eat heavy protein foods. It's not the right time. And otherwise, you'll get really irritable. Keep away from lots of fried foods. Have a little bit of oil in your cooking. It's a good time. But deep fried foods, especially foods that are fried and then let cool down. There used to be laws here about frying food and cooling it down and how toxic it is, especially that stuff in cabinet windows that has been pre-fried and let cool down. Cheese on pizzas, chips in those packets that have been fried and in vegetable oil and who knows what kind of oil. Peanut oil is fairly nasty as an oil. But who knows what's going on in the restaurants? I mean, all I know is that the cheapest oil you can get, and I think most of the restaurants use it, is imitation peanut oil. Oh my God, what is that? All I know is that it's pretty toxic. Be scared of it. Use good quality oil at home. Keep away from heavy saturated fat, and you'll be supporting yourself the best possible way for a great time of change and excitement. And I really feel this spring that's coming for us here in Australia will be very dynamic, really exciting time. Let's put our dreams in place and let's nurture them with the right attitude and let it unfold, and then the work comes later.
Not everyone who is listening to this is going to have family members on the same page. When you're suggesting those dietary changes, that's a really good way for family members to support siblings or parents or partners with regards to what you're saying, isn't it? So cook differently and present food in different ways and just in non-verbal ways try to support that process in the household.
It's a great time of just going more vegetarian, less heavy food. Heavy food in winter, heavy food in autumn maybe, where there's an excess of animals in nature and then the food dies down in winter and there's more chance for us to easily gather that kind of food. Now, though, it's not that time. It's the wrong time for heavy saturated fat. Reduce your eggs, reduce your dairy, or avoid them altogether. And just go light. It's the right time to go light. Even if you're nutritionally deficient, it's the right time to go really light. And you'll find that you can get all of those sort of nutrients you need from your vegetables, like beans and peas and carrots and pumpkin. And it goes on and on, all the different squashes. There's lots of great nutrients in there available to us to rebuild. And you can be very clever with your family and friends, and hot, yummy, fresh soups, a great thing. Learn to make food that is supportive of your family. And it's all about labeling too, where you can call a hearty soup made from noodles and vegetables. You can call it all sorts of things, and you know, you can call it beef soup, whatever you want. Just throw some beans in there. It's okay to fry up some tofu and call it a steak sandwich. It's all right to make a dessert with no sugar in it and not call it a healthy dessert. Just call it a dessert and a cake. It's all to do with labeling, especially with the kids.
Yeah, that's good. That's great. Another question I had, which came out of your introduction, all these questions, I'm sure our listeners have tons of questions too, but the concept of fresh air and dawn and that beautiful little whisper of air that you get on your face and setting intention and all that sort of stuff, that lends itself to splashing cold water on your face, jumping in a freezing cold swimming pool or in the ocean or a cold shower. Is now the right time to reintroduce that, or can you make some comments around physically what we should be doing to support ourselves?
That early time, just before the sun is coming up, is a time when we're just quiet and we're letting it all bubble up around us. Start your processes. Enjoy your life that way. See it as a precious thing. Go back to bed later, but get up in the morning. Create your dream. Feel that little early time before dawn, just at dawn. The rest of the world is waking up or awake. And enjoy that little moment and let that start to happen. So then we spend that little time just quietly moving in the early morning stillness, and it's a little bit dark and the sun's just starting to come up. You'll feel that little whisper of possibilities and dreams come through just before the sun comes up, and then start our processes of maybe putting a little bit of cold water on our face and sitting quietly and watching the breath, and let yourself transition from sleeping to wakefulness. It's a good time. You can do it just by sitting up in bed and feeling your breath and just be still and let that energy just slowly come. You'll feel it. It's a dramatic thing. Maybe 2 minutes of just sitting quietly in a upright position, maybe in a meditation pose if you know one, and watch your breath. Just be open. Don't try and force anything. Let the world manifest around you and within you. Just watch your breath. Rather than thinking, I should think this and I should think that, sit quietly and let it bubble up. It'll come 1 minute, 2 minutes, and waking up will come. A new state of consciousness will come, which is your waking state. And that waking state then can be used to start doing things, walking around and start getting ready for a little bit of activity. Just enough to push you to your limit. Maybe holding a pose, a yoga pose, maybe going for a jog. But we need to do something active, something clear, something that challenges us in some way. And for some of us, that might be just getting up as the greatest thing you've ever achieved in your life. Others of us might be that we go for a jog. Others of us might be doing some sit-ups. But I'm sure some of you, just getting up will be a great accomplishment. And then even if the rest of the day doesn't unfold really beautifully for you and you have some drama, at least you got up and started the process of creating a new way of dealing with every morning.
So people who have never done this before but are feeling quite inspired about it, is it as simple as setting the alarm 15 minutes earlier and creating that space as their own sacred space before they then get into the hectic daily routine to get off to work and school and things like that?
Yeah, society is very dramatic now with all of that, where we're all living in nuclear families and we're not well enough or generous enough or flexible enough to share our lives, and we're on our own, and it's tricky. It's difficult. It's there's a lot of pressures around us in the mornings. But on the other hand, it's what we've got to deal with, and just having the idea that we're amazing creatures and we can deal with a lot. And if you're well, you can cope with enormous amounts and actually enjoy it. Yeah, getting up a little bit earlier prepares you for all of that. I know some of you are already getting up before dawn, but sitting quietly and just planning the day after sitting quietly and watching your breath and just planning the day, just going gently at it rather than sitting up with negativity, regret, and stress. It's the wrong thing to lie there and let things mull over in your head and then stress yourself to get up, which is thinking, oh, if I don't get up, then this, and this will happen. Oh my God, start to panic, and then we get up. It's so the wrong way. The right thing, much better to do, is to just sit up, watch your breath for a minute, and let yourself consciously slide into wakefulness. It's a much better way. And then you'll see the day unfold so much better and much easier. And your attitude will set the environment for everyone around you, whether you're a teenager, whether you're the mum in the family, whether you're the dad in the family, or whether you're one of the blokes in the house full of different blokes, or one of the girls in a house full of different people. Your energy, your attitude will, because it's superior, will infect everyone else around you, and it'll make a huge impact. Everyone else will calm down and feel light and bouncy and well. I had a lovely friend who, at dinners, he was an amazing creature, and we would all be talking, and some little negativity would pop up. And then there'd be a little moment at the end where he'd say something which would make it all positive. So we might be saying things like, oh, that person this and that person that. And as an example, maybe a little bit negative about Donald Trump or something. And then he'd say something a little bit positive, and it would just change the idea, the mood. Just from his attitude, the whole table would feel happy and light and positive again.
Everybody has the power to do that, and bringing it back to the concept of spring, if we think about dawn as spring, and it's a gentle time, and it's a time for renewal, and it's a time for setting intention, then that's an amazing gift that people can give themselves and other people.
Absolutely. And it may be one of your things might be, I'm going to be more flexible and create more light around me, and more happiness and abundance for everyone else around me also, you know, and why not? And I'm just going to say positive things, you know. I mean, there's silliness. It's really idiotic to have a fridge magnet that says I'm 6 foot tall, blonde, and extremely young and attractive, and you're 4 foot three and you know, well into your late middle age, and nothing's happening like that at all. You know, I mean, it's just dumb. That's just schizophrenia. I mean, it's silly. But there are great dreams that we can have, yeah? It's no point in being unrealistic. On the other hand, having a great dream for yourself and those around you, where you can have lots and lots of abundance and have great, great, great joy and happiness around you all the time, we can make great strides towards that, and maybe even looking deeper inside us. But it all starts with us now in spring just being still and enjoying the energy. It's not about doing great stuff. It's just about having the dream. That's why it's so exciting. It's where we can practice new directions. And a new direction is looking. A new direction is turning your head, using your eyes, and creating a new vision for ourselves inside and around us, where, as an analogy, we turn and we twist. You know, we take a step in a new direction. And it starts with just using your eyes and turning your head and looking in a different way, or looking at the same thing in a different way. It's not about even really doing anything. It's the beginnings. And now's the time of those beginnings. The hard work comes later. So it's that sitting quietly, watching your breath, and trying to set a new standard for us, and maybe following through that a little bit as the morning unravels. And it'll just bubble up. You'll see. It'll just bubble up. And that's the time we can do that. The rest of the year doesn't have that potential where you can sit quietly, create a new idea, a new direction in your life that you personally want, and let that manifest, and then just follow it, see what happens.
Wonderful. That's great. I think that's a nice note to end on, don't you?
I think it's perfect. Thank you, Maggie.
I think it's perfect too. I think there's everybody listening, I'm sure, is incredibly inspired and excited to get up early and use some special time to think about the day. And
just the next couple of weeks, just while it's there over November, why not? And then sleep in for the rest of the year.
Yes. Or just delay spring every day for an hour. The seasons of change. Thank you, Andre. Another great podcast, and we'll catch you next time.
I hope everyone enjoys it, and I hope they all have wonderful dreams manifesting for them. Please let us know how it goes for you.
Any listeners who would like to learn more about Andre's work or Rioho can connect and follow on Instagram and LinkedIn using the address of Rioho Wellness. We spell Rioho R-Y-O-H-O and then add wellness on the end, obviously. Episode notes will be loaded up and available at riohowellness.com, which is the master website. And just a few more things before you take off. Number one, do you have a health issue or question you would like explored in one of our podcasts? Please submit it to us at the website where there is a contact page, riohowellness.com website. Number two, would you enjoy being notified by very short email every time we do something on Rioho Wellness? This includes notification of our up-and-coming wellness podcasts and other things towards our tipping point. If you want to receive that, go to riohowellness.com and drop in your email address and you'll get the very next one. And we hope you really enjoy it. Thanks everyone for listening, and thank you, Andre, for another fantastic episode. See you next time.